wanting more than fine. Call me Jim, please. His left hand in his pocket, he holds his right hand out to me, as though we're equals. Thank you, doctor, I mean, just Jim, I say. He chuckles.
Haven't done anything yet.
He has. No older man ever invited me to shake hands. No other adult ever asked me to call them by name. He even said please, although I'm a patient. A smile tugs at face muscles I haven't used for a while. My hand slips into his, as though it remembers his touch, and we've held hands often in a previous life.
Think it over, he says. Take as long as you need.
I let my fingers stay in his pale palm, like brown roots sinking into chalky white soil. I'll do it.
Good, Dr. Murli says. He'll have you walking fine in no time.
I don't want to walk fine. I want to dance.
Penguin Random House Audio presents A Time to Dance. This is the author, Padma Venkatraman. As this book neared completion, I was struck by the story of a dancer, Adrian Haslett Davis, who had a limb amputated as a result of the Boston Marathon bombing. This work is dedicated to the courageous people I've been privileged to meet and those whom I'll never be honored to know, whose spirit triumphs over terror and tragedy. Prologue. Temple of the Dancing God. Clinging to the free end of Ma's sari, I follow the tired shuffle of other pilgrims' feet into the cool darkness of the temple, where sweat smell mingles with the fragrance of incense. Pa's hand rests heavy on my curls. The priest drops a pinch of sacred ash into Ma's palm, and she smears it on my forehead, above the red dot she paints between my eyebrows each morning. I push through the rustling curtain of women's saris and men's white veshtis, tiptoeing to see better. A bronze statue of Shiva, four-armed god of dance, glistens. He balances on his right leg alone, his left raised parallel to earth, the crescent moon, a sparkling jewel he wears in his matted hair. Carved high into the temple's granite walls are other celestial dancers. Pa, I tug at my father's shirt. He lifts me onto his shoulders, but the sculptures are too far away to touch. After the crowd empties out into the sunshine of the temple courtyard, I, alone, slip back into the soft blackness of the empty hall, spot a stepladder propped against my dancer-filled wall, and climb up, up, up to the very top. Leaning forward, I trace dancing feet with my fingertips. What are you doing, little one? A priest steadies my ladder. You don't have to climb ladders to reach God. He dances within all he creates. Come down. I run my fingers along the curve of each stone heel. The priest's laugh rumbles up into my ears. Place a hand on your chest. Can you feel Shiva's feet
moving inside you?
I press on my chest, feel bony ribs. Under them, thumping, faint echoes of a dance rhythm. Thom, thom, thom. Shiva, outside me, gleaming in the temple sanctum, yet also leaping, hidden inside my body. God is everywhere, in everybody, in everything. He is born at different times, in different places, with different names. He dances in heaven as Shiva, creator of universes. He lived on earth as Buddha, human incarnation of compassion. And, as you can see, he moves within you. Now, please, come down, little one. I'm halfway down the ladder when Pa and Ma rush back in. Pa prostrates, laying his squat body flat on the stone floor, thanking God. Ma thanks the priest, words of gratitude bursting from her like sobs. Searched the other four temples, couldn't find her. So scared, what if she'd left the temple complex, run outside the walls, into the city? As we leave, Ma's thin fingers pinch my shoulders, tight as tongs roasting rotis over an open flame. Pa scolds, "You could have burst your head, climbing a ladder like that." My head is bursting with images of stone dancers come alive, the tips of their bare toes twirling with sounds of the tiny bells on their anklets twinkling with music.
A Time to Dance. Hoping and waiting.
I race upstairs, kick my sandals off outside our front door, burst into our apartment. I'm in the finals. My grandmother, Pati, surges out of the kitchen like a ship in full sail, her white sari dazzling in the afternoon light that streams through our open windows. I fling my arms around her, drink in the spicy sweet basil and aloe scent of her soap. Pati doesn't say congratulations. She doesn't need to. I feel her words in the warmth of her hug. I knew you'd make it. Pa plucks me out of Pati's embrace into his arms.
Finals of what? Ma says.
I've only been talking about the Bharatanatyam dance competition for months, mostly to Pati and to Pa, but Ma's hearing is perfect, and we don't live in a palace with soundproof walls.
Pati retreats into the kitchen. Pati's told me she doesn't think it's her place to interfere with her son and daughter-in-law. Pa's eyes rove from Ma to me. He's caught in the middle, as always. Ma's diamond earrings, the only reminder of her wealthy past, flash at me like angry eyes.
Veda, you need to study hard. If you don't do well in your exams this year...
For once, my voice doesn't stick in my throat.
I am studying hard to be a dancer. I'm not planning to become an engineer or a doctor.
Or any other profession Ma finds respectable.
Ma launches into her usual lecture. Dancing is no career for a middle-class girl. You need to study something useful in college so you can get a well-paid job.
I sigh, extra loud.
My dance teacher, Udayana, isn't rich, but his house is larger than ours. Clearly, he earns more than Ma at her bank job and Pa at his library. Ma goes on and on. Back when I was younger, I'd struggle to be better at school, for Ma's sake.
But numbers and letters soon grew too large for me to hold, and I grew far away from them, and Ma grew out of patience. Party places steaming soji, my favorite snack, on our table. The sweet, buttery smell of cooked semolina is tempting, but I leave the plate untouched. March into the bedroom Party and I share. Slam the door. Pa knocks. Says, "Come out, Veda. Eat something." "Leave her alone," Ma says. "She knows where to find food, if she's hungry." I probably shouldn't have slammed the door. But Ma never even said congratulations. She's never pretended my dancing made her happy. But never has a performance mattered more to me than being chosen for the finals of this competition. All my life, Ma's been hoping I'll do well at science and mathematics so I could end up becoming what she wanted to be, an engineer. All my life, I've been waiting for her to appreciate my love of the one thing I excel at, Bharatanatyam dance. Speaking with hands. Steps came to you early. Speech came late, Party said. She'd tell how she watched me pull myself up by the bars of my cradle at 8 months, eager to toddle on my own 2 feet. Months before others my age, she said, I could shape thoughts with my fingers. My body wasn't shy. While words stumbled in my throat, losing their way long before they reached my lips, like lotus buds blossoming, my hands spoke my first sentences, shaping themselves into hasta mudras, the hand symbols of Indian classical dance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.